Joining us here on Observations from MSU on WMSV 91.1 FM is Wally P. from Tucson, Arizona. He is a member of the 12-step community. He's an archivist, historian, and author. His primary area of interest is the miraculous growth of the 12-step movement in the 1940s. He'll be on the campus of MSU on Tuesday, November the 28th, putting on a seminar, Back to Basics of Recovery, How to Take the 12 Steps Quickly and Often, Tuesday the 28th, 6 o'clock, Taylor Auditorium, McCool Hall. Wally, good to have you on.
Great to be part of this miraculous journey, this recovery journey.
So what exactly will be the theme of Back to Basics, the event that is taking place on Tuesday?
Well, the event on Tuesday is based on 22 handouts that have already been sent in, so everybody in attendance will get a complete handout packet, and we are going to take everybody in the room through all 12 steps in three 40-minute sessions. Yes, all of the steps, including a 20-25-minute breakout where one-on-one we do the fourth and fifth steps. After matching everybody up as sharing partners. Nobody takes the steps alone. We are going to take them together with the exception of four and five, which will be a breakout session so that people can do those two steps one-on-one.
We should mention that Wally's visit to campus is sponsored by the Collegiate Recovery Community that is here at Mississippi State. So when you say, Wally, back to basics, so what do you mean exactly?
Well, Back to Basics is a reenactment of a series of 1946 AA beginners meetings during which all participants took all 12 steps in 4 one-hour sessions. This is the primary reason that the first of the 12-step programs did have a 50 to 75% recovery rate during the 1940s and 1950s. This meeting format has all but been lost to the 12-step community. I was asked to write a book on the intergroup and central offices in the 1940s, and which I completed in 1995, but it gave me open access to every archival collection in the United States and Canada. I walked out of this project with 70,000 pages of historical documentation. But what I found is that the beginners meetings permeated the entire recovery community during this period of time. And it was as simple as you walked into your first meeting, you were greeted at the door and assigned a sponsor. The sponsor chose the newcomers. The newcomers didn't choose the sponsors. And the two of you would go into the back room and actually take the 12 steps in the back room while the regular meeting was going on in the front room. After you had completed all 12 steps, you were introduced to the group, and then you were put on the list to sponsor other people through the steps. So when your name came to the top, you got a newcomer, and the two of you went into the back room. And not only did you learn how to take the steps, but you learned how to sponsor other people through the steps in the beginner's meetings in the back room. As I said, it's an all but lost piece of our history, but it did provide us with a 50 to 75% recovery rate during the early days.
So why has it been lost?
Okay, very controversial question. I love the controversy. I have the big, broad shoulders. I take heat everywhere I go because I'm talking about a program that most people have never even heard of. But what happened, the beginners meeting spread throughout the entire country, started in Cleveland, Ohio in 1941, St. Louis in 1942, spread throughout the entire country. Over one half of the group actually sponsored a beginners meeting in the back room. Or the alternative to that is the meetings were held before the regular meetings. So you'd go an hour and 15 minutes early, do the beginners meetings, and then the regular meeting was shortly after that, especially if it was a speaker meeting, because that was open to everybody. But in the early 1950s, Bill W., one of the co-founders of the first of the 12-step programs, wrote a book titled The 12 Steps and the 12 Traditions. He wrote it as a supplement to the big book, but it was misinterpreted by the fellowship as a replacement for the big book. And so the beginners meetings, which were highly successful in the 40s and 50s, by the 60s and 70s, had been almost universally replaced with step studies out of the 12 and 12. But there are no directions on taking the steps out of the 12 and 12. So beginners meetings where you took the steps became step studies where you sat there and studied the steps. And the result in terms of recovery rates was dramatically and drastically reduced.
So what are the recovery rates today?
Depending upon who you talk to, the General Service Office in New York, which is the headquarters of the first of the 12-step programs, they send out surveys every few years. And home group secretaries will fill out the survey and send it in. They also publish once a year the actual number of members and the number of groups. This is confidential information, but it does lead one to believe the recovery rate is somewhere around 5 to 7%. But the kicker, which is in the public domain, are the chip manufacturing companies, the companies that manufacture the medallions. And all you have to do is add up the number of 24-hour chips that are given out versus one-month chips versus three-month chips versus one-year chips versus five-year chips, and you come up with the same numbers, 5 to 7% recovery. So there is information out in the public domain, but there's also confidential information, which I can give you the summary, but I can't tell you how they come up with it.
So, in summary, and you've already touched on this a little bit, Wally, what made it so much more successful in the 40s?
Well, first of all, taking the steps were not an option. There are only three meeting formats in the 1940s, and this is validated in the handbook for the secretary. First published in 1949, but even through the 1950s, there were only three meeting formats that were listed. Open speaker meetings, in which a format was used called 10-10-40, 10 minutes of what it was like, 10 minutes of what happened, and 40 minutes how God and the steps changed your life. And if you didn't have 40 minutes to share on how God and the steps changed your life, you were not asked to speak at a meeting. You were pre-screened by the host committee, and they would either give you the thumbs up or the thumbs down. And if you didn't have 40 minutes on how the God and the steps changed your life, then you were asked to go back to your group, and later you would be re-interviewed, and hopefully by that time you would have 40 minutes. The second meeting format were closed discussion meetings, and they weren't to discuss your problems. They were only to discuss the solution as found in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. So these were the original Big Book studies and the beginner's meetings where you took all 12 steps in 4 one-hour sessions. Those were the only approved meeting formats that came out of New York City during this period of time. I didn't mention open discussion meetings because that format did not exist. That format did not even become part of the recovery community until the late 1970s. And that also has contributed to a lot of confusion and a lot of people not hearing the solution and walking back out of the room. So my mission is to get people not only into the rooms but to stay in the rooms once they know how simple the process really is, and anybody and everybody can take all 12 steps in basically 2 to 3 hours.
Now, I know, Wally, and as I did a little bit of research before getting on the phone with you. I did not know there were so many. I knew there were several 12-step programs. I did not realize there were a couple of hundred 12-step programs. Yeah. What are some of the major differences, and does it matter which one someone wanting to get into recovery goes through?
Well, let me take you back prior to the writing of the big book. In the 1930s, again, the 12-step community evolved from three fellowships. The Emanuel Movement, which started at the Emanuel Church in Boston, Massachusetts in 1909, they discovered that those who were of service to others stayed sober, and those that just went through treatment had and never helped another person along the way or took on a service commitment, they didn't stay sober. And again, this was both for drug addiction and alcoholism, so everybody was in the same room. The New Thought Movement, which was headed up by, in the United States, Emmett Fox, and the New Thought Movement had to do with love and tolerance is our code. Bill W. and Lois, his wife, went to listen to Emmett Fox every Saturday night. I do have a copy of all of his teachings. He didn't even call them sermons. He called them teachings. And much of his work ended up in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous. But the key program was the Oxford Group. And they were quite successful in the 1930s. They had a four spiritual activity program based on surrender, sharing, amends, and guidance. And these are the steps that Bill took, Dr. Bob took, and the first 100 took. One of the misstatements in the big book on page 59 is here are the steps we took, which isn't true. The first 100 took the four spiritual activities. Bill tipped the 12 steps in within 4 weeks of the book going to the publisher, or at least the manuscript going out to the world, and nobody had time to take the 12 steps. So everybody knew the four spiritual activities worked. Bill converted them from 4 to 12, complicated it a little bit. But the key to the process is that it was Dr. Bob and other pioneers that realized the big book was far too complicated for newcomers, and they stripped 95% of the big book out of the beginners meetings. That's how you can take the steps in 2 to 3 hours, by cutting it down to 50 key paragraphs, 30 key paragraphs. But the key is Bill wrote the book, but Dr. Bob taught us how to interpret the book in a way which was indeed miraculous because it was so successful.
Now, I know one of the key concepts that you discuss in your workshops and you'll discuss here on the MSU campus on Tuesday is the voice of addiction versus the voice of recovery. What does that mean?
Okay, now, the voice of addiction versus the voice of recovery is a Wally P. interpretation of the process.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to take you back to the big book. First of all, the Oxford Group, in addition to having four spiritual activities, which are basically four steps, they did have a four-way test to distinguish between self-will and God's will, between ego and spirit. And that's what is actually in the big book. Bill reversed the four spiritual he reversed the four-way test and gave us the opposite. So what is actually part of the four-way test would be honesty, purity, unselfishness, and love. Bill reversed them in steps 4, 10, and 11 because he didn't want to be accused of direct plagiarism and gave us selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. Now, and it's also the liability side of an assets and liabilities checklist, which is what they used in step 4 during this period of time. And the assets, again, were the four-way test, honesty, purity, unselfishness, and love. So you could tell the difference of whether or not you were on the liability side of the sheet or the asset side of the sheet. But what I added to it starting about 5 years ago is the voice of addiction versus the voice of recovery. Which voice are you listening to? We all have an inner dialogue. We all have an inner voice. Is that inner voice based on addiction or is that inner voice based on recovery? The voice of addiction is based in selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. The voice of recovery is based in honesty, purity, unselfishness, and love. Once you realize just how simple the process is, because the only question that you need to answer each and every day is which voice you're listening to. If you're listening to the voice of addiction, good luck. I mean, that's what relapse is all about. But if you're listening to the voice of recovery, you get to stay clean and sober one day at a time for the rest of your life. And that's the miracle of what went down in the writing of the big book, and also how the big book was implemented during the early days.
How often throughout the year, Wally, do you get a chance to travel and to do workshops like this?
I'm traveling about 70% of the time personally, and there's thousands of other people that also do this work. There are people who have presented all over the state of Mississippi. I know them personally. But what an honor for me to actually come to Starkville and get to witness all these miracles myself. I personally have taken 100,000 people through the steps. If you do 150 to 300 every other weekend for 22 years, it comes up to well over 100,000 people. But like I said, there's thousands of other people doing this. So all told, between myself and others, we've taken 700,000 people through the steps using this very simple, straightforward, 2 to 3 hour process. And there's 500,000 people alive today who wouldn't be alive if I hadn't resurrected that original part of our program of recovery.
And the workshops are free of charge, correct?
Yes. Not only are they free of charge, but I'm free of charge. I've written 4 books. I make no money from the sale of any literature that has my name on it. And the reason for that is I consider this to be my 12-step work. And based on our traditions, I cannot accept money for anything that's based on 12-step work. So this is my 12-step work for which I cannot be paid. So that's an integral part of it. Usually the workshops have either they pass the basket, they're hosted by a university or by an umbrella organization, National Council on Alcoholism and Drug Addiction or Drug Dependency. They host me a lot. Treatment centers host me a lot of times, aftercare facilities. I'm in prisons on a regular basis taking people that are behind the walls through the steps, and all this is done for fun and for free, which is the way it was intended to be.
We are short on time, Wally, but I want to go ahead and ask you, for those who are wanting to attend, are planning to attend on Tuesday from 6 to 9 o'clock in a Taylor Auditorium of McCool Hall on campus at MSU in Starkville, What should they expect for those 3 hours?
Well, first of all, we are going to be giving them 22 pages of handouts so that they can follow the process. And we are going to match everybody up as sharing partners because nobody takes the steps alone. We are going to have 2 breaks. The first break is after the first 3 steps, which normally takes 15 minutes or less in total, but we do some introductory work. And then they get to meet their sharing partners if they haven't met them already. Then we go back and we do steps 4 through 9. Then we do the breakout session where everybody actually pairs off and goes to separate parts of the auditorium or the facility and discusses steps 4 through 9 with their partner. Then they change roles and the person will share with you during this period of time, and then we come back and take steps 10, 11, and 12. Simple, straightforward, and it works. It really does.
Wally P. has been our guest here on Observations from MSU on 91.1 WMSV, Back to Basics of Recovery, How to Take the 12 Steps Quickly and often McCool Hall, Taylor Auditorium on the campus of Mississippi State University, November 28th, 6 to 9 p.m. Wally, thank you so much for being here. I've thoroughly enjoyed it.
My pleasure, and look forward to meeting you in person on Tuesday night. I'm also getting a tour of the campus, and hopefully the radio station will be part of that tour Tuesday during the day. So I'm really looking forward to getting plugged into the collegiate recovery community at MSU.
If the station's not already on the agenda, just request that it be added, and we'll enjoy meeting up with you on Tuesday.
Absolutely. I'm all in.